Yeah, then we can start now.
Okay.
Welcome everyone. Today, this is the first Crash Course seminar that we'll be running. As you know, like there is a lot to read in mathematics, and I think if people just start giving lectures on whatever topics they know, I think it would be helpful for others. We'll be trying to cover some major topics, and diverse topics also. It's not just going to be algebra, and hope I can find more people to give lectures on other topics. Today, Akash will be presenting the first lecture of like 7 to 8 part lectures on introduction to algebraic number theory. And I'll stop my I'll mute myself. Akash, you can start.
Yeah. Okay. So we'll today start with this Marcus chapter 2 of Marcus. And before getting into the number fields and everything, first I'll talk about the definitions and basic properties of some integral extension, or actually what it means. So if we have two rings, say R and S, we say that like I'll take some x from S and I'll call x to be integral over R if it satisfies some monic polynomial equation over R. So we will show that if you have like this setup S and R and you take the collection of all integral elements, that they actually form a ring. So for our setup, we will have that this R will be Z, and we will try to see that this S is some kind of ring sitting inside some finite extension of Q. So this is the first thing, that the definition of integral extension. And now some just very basic properties, that if you have your R and if you have say some other ring, say L, so R to L, this extension is say integral. And if you take some multiplicative set inside R, say S, then S inverse R and S inverse L, you took these two rings, then this new extension is also an integral extension. So now we'll start with the definition of number field. It's the first line. So this is just a subfield of C having a finite degree over Q. So as we know that any finite extension over Q is separable, so we know that it is actually generated by a single element. So you can take that K to be Q alpha. So example is by Q to and Q and QI. So that's a number field over Q. Okay. So before this was the definition of number field. Now we'll definition of algebraic integer. So some a complex number is an algebraic integer if it is root of some monic polynomial with coefficients in Z. Now this is something that you have to be careful. Like we are taking the polynomial equation in Z, not in Q. So one example is like say again I. I is an algebraic integer because it satisfies x square plus 1. But on the other hand, say any rational p by q, which is inside Q, but it doesn't satisfy any monic polynomial equation over Z, so it can't be actually an algebraic integer. So just a small trick. Show you. Yeah. So just I think everyone can see this. There is an equation, say a naught plus a1 alpha plus dot 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 a n minus 1 alpha n minus 1. So suppose you have an alpha which actually satisfies an equation, this polynomial equation over Q, and each ai is in Q. So now what you do is, so we don't know that whether it is an algebraic integer because we don't know whether these ai's are in Z or not. But what you can do is, so if you take this ai's and this just clear the denominators, then you will get an equation. So when it was over Q, it was monic, but now you have like multiplied with some integer, cleared out the denominators, but in the monic place you have say some R times alpha n plus something. So what will you do now? You will just multiply R to the power n minus 1. That's how you get R alpha whole to the power n plus something. So the whole thing is, the trick is that if you have any alpha which satisfies an monic polynomial equation over Q, then there exists an R in Z such that R alpha will be an algebraic integer. So that is the thing. So like if you take like all the integral elements which are integral over Q, and if you quotient it with the algebraic integers, then you take any element x, then you know that its order is finite in this quotient group or whatever. So yeah, this was thing one thing. Yeah, this is complex number algebraic integer. Yeah, this is this lemma. Yeah, so this is very important actually. It will help us to show that if I have taken, I have started with Z, then I'm talking about say the collection of all elements in C which are algebraic over Z. So we don't know now whether they make a ring or not, but we'll show now that actually they form a ring. So these are the statements and these are equivalent. So here alpha is an algebraic integer, the additive group of the ring ZA is finitely generated, alpha is a member of some subring of C having a finitely generated additive group, and alpha A is inside A for some finitely generated additive group, subgroup of A. So the main part proving actually in this whole statement is actually this 4 implies 1. The other things are pretty straightforward, it's trivial. So I'll show that how you do this 4 cup thing. So what will you start with? Let us say that you know that A is finitely generated subgroup, a Z module. So what you do is you start, you first pick up some generator, say alpha 1 to alpha n.
Akash, can you scroll now, down?
Yeah. Can you see?
Like, yeah, it's fine. Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah. So this A1 to AN, say this thing generates A. And now first what will you do is just multiply every AI with our A or alpha. So alpha AI are our elements. Now, yeah. So now see this relation. So how are you getting this relation? So our each alpha AI can be like, it is an element in A again. And because that is our condition that alpha into A is inside A. So as it is inside A, I can say that this is some summation Ci Ai. So that's how we get the matrix M. So you can say that this, now of course you do the usual thing. You take alpha I minus M, A1 to An, and that is going to be zero. Now as alpha A1 to An are generators, they can't be zero. I mean our A is non-zero module. So we have a non-zero solution to this matrix. So we know the determinant is going to be zero. So now if you see the determinant of this matrix, so how does it looks like? Basically it looks like the diagonal. In the diagonal you have some alpha minus Ci and the rest of the place you have some integer. So if you take the determinant, you will actually get like the top degree of alpha, say alpha to the power n, that's going to be monic. Like there is no other choice, like some coefficient is coming along this alpha. So from there you can see that this is the given here. So from here you can say that okay, then alpha actually satisfies the monic polynomial equation, and that's why you can say that okay, alpha is going to be an algebraic integer. So now we are going to use this to actually show that our element, like extension of all algebraic elements, are going to form a ring. How are we going to do that? First take some x and y which are algebraic over Z. So if you take that x and y, A, alpha and beta are algebraic integers, and so are alpha plus beta and alpha beta. So what are you going to take? Our A will be just Z of alpha comma beta. Now of course as alpha is algebraic, we know that Z alpha is a finitely generated Z module, so is Z beta. So we can say that Z alpha beta, this is going to be a finitely generated Z module. Now if you just take our alpha to be just alpha plus beta, multiply with Z alpha beta, then you get like the apply the previous theorem, and you can see that alpha plus beta, both alpha plus beta and alpha into beta is going to satisfy some monic polynomial equation over Z. So hence you can say that okay, now you have the collection of all algebraic integers forms a ring. Actually we are not going to work with the whole this collection, we call it big O. What we are going to do is first we are going to take a number field that gave the definition earlier, that it is a finite extension of Q in C. So now we have this ring O, like the elements of which are algebraic over Z. So now we are taking O intersection K. So basically now we are taking those elements in K which satisfies a monic equation over Z. We call this OK, and we call this to be the ring of integers in K. This is your number ring or whatever ring of integers. This is the thing. Okay. So one example is, if you think about it, just take K to be QI. I is a complex number. So now you can see that your the elements which actually can satisfy a monic equation are only A plus I beta, like A plus IB, where A and B are both in Z. So basically you can, like, it is easy to show that the ring of integers in QI is going to be ZI. So now one might think that whether this, like of course I can always take my K to be some Q alpha, because it is a separable extension, finite, hence it is going to be generated by Q alpha. Now one might think that whether every OK is of the form Z alpha or not. That's not true. That no, like there can be much more elements inside that. We'll see one example just I think everyone has seen this, the what are the cyclotomic fields are. Basically it is like you take any M and then you take the mth root of unity inside C, say omega, and that's actually like Q omega is your cyclotomic field. You know that it satisfies monic polynomial, monic irreducible polynomial of degree phi m over Z. So omega is actually an algebraic integer. So we'll show that for Q omega, that is one of the main computation we're going to do today. We will show that in Q omega, the ring of integers OK is going to be Z omega. This is in the ring. Okay, yeah. Now one very important concept called the trace and norms. Okay, so think about it, like you have K, a number field, and over Q, say its degree is N. So now we are considering, as we can see, that K is like some Q alpha generated by some single element. So what are the, it's like C embeddings, Q embeddings of K. So if you have a, say, sigma, which is from K to C, and which is an embedding, then it actually depends like where you can send alpha to. So as the degree, like the degree of the extension is N, there are N many choices, say alpha 1 to alpha N, and these are, this will correspond to your embedding, say sigma I. So what you do is, now you take your alpha and you take trace of alpha to be the summation of this embedding. Now one thing is there, that like as I am defining this, there should be like they have done it like after this, but they should put some like T K alpha, because the trace actually, like you have taken any random elements from K and you have for K this fixed embedding sigma 1 to sigma n. When you take the summation, actually, it actually depends, like alpha can be in several fields, right? So it depends actually upon your like choice of K. So if you take different K, it will be a different trace. So actually it should be written like TK alpha. So this was the of trace. Norm is like defined similarly. Norm is defined as you take norm of alpha to be just the product of this, all the embeddings of alpha. Now you can see, like of course, like if you take norm times C of alpha, C is in Z, it will be C to the power N, or in norm of alpha, trace just happens like the same thing. So yeah, here they have given a good thing, that we took alpha from some field K, some finite extension of Q. Now I can just take, say, Q alpha to just begin with, and what I have got in that Q alpha, I'll notate it by just small t alpha. Suppose the extension degree of Q alpha dot Q is just D. Suppose that is the case. Then this is a theorem actually stating that the TKA, TK alpha with respect to K, that is going to be N by D. And then this, if you take like TQ alpha of alpha, like small t alpha. This is the like the relation between them. And you can actually see like where this n by d is coming from actually, because when you see like you take k and you think about all of its embedding, like so just extend everything to a Galois closure. Just extend everything to a Galois closure. Then you have these things, extension will be n, and your q alpha's extension will be d. Then they have their like group of automorphism, and their quotient will be n by d. So basically, they are two representative one element, and that's how we are getting this n by d. So actually, for small t alpha, when you are taking each alpha I actually occurs n by d times when you are taking in this big t alpha. So that's how they are getting it. Okay, this for any k, now just this is for any k field, you are taking tk alpha and nk alpha, they are rational, they are actually going to be integer. Why? Because if you see that what was tk alpha, so before even proving for tk alpha, just see this formula once. So if I can prove that our small t alpha is inside, it's a rational, then we are done anyway. Because for all any other extension, we'll get some n by d kind of thing, and we are done. So I'll just prove that this small t alpha and this small n alpha, they are both rational, and we'll be done. So how are you going to do it? Yeah. So again, this t alpha and l alpha are rational. This is clear because, like, how are you getting the t alpha? It is just the you take the irreducible polynomial, minimal polynomial of alpha, and t alpha is the just x to the power n minus x to the power d minus 1's coefficient, and the n alpha is just the constant coefficient, and of course they are both in Q. Now one thing is that why do I say that it's in Z? Because if you think about it, like both t alpha, tk alpha and nk alpha, we know that they are rational. On the other hand, if you see about think about it, that if suppose alpha satisfies the monic equation over Z, alpha is an algebraic integer. Now each of the embeddings, as I said, that we are talking about Q embeddings, which fixes Q. So if alpha satisfies an algebraic equation, monic algebraic equation over Z, then of course sigma is also going to satisfy the same equation. So and their product is also going to be algebraic integer as we did it, because it's a ring. So now we can say that product of alpha is sigma alpha, and summation of sigma alpha, both are algebraic. Now so we have our in our hand that we have two numbers, say tk alpha and nk alpha. We know that they are going to be rational, and we know that they are going to be algebraic. Now this is an easy check to do, that if I have p by q some rational, and it satisfies some monic equation over Z, then we must have that q is equal to 1. So it is doable, it is easy to check that. So now they are writing it. Yeah. Now they are actually writing. Yeah, and again, like this trace and norms are transitive. Like if you have K inside L inside M, then you have this relation. Just see it for a moment. Nothing surprising or anything. Okay, we should move on. Okay, now this is a very interesting concept called the discriminant of an interval. So as we have seen that I'm just starting with the number field of degree n over q. Let us this sigma I is our embedding. Now you pick any interval of elements, say alpha 1 to alpha n, and define the discriminant by, you take the matrix which aij entries are sigma I alpha j, and then you take its square. That is going to be your discriminant. Now why that, I mean, why are we taking the square actually? So if I have like the, I will say in a moment that this discriminant, the notion of the discriminant is actually meant for to classify some kind of like numbering, to attach with each number ring one number. So it's kind of, if you pick like two different bases, whether they give you the same discriminant or not. For that, this is like a technical result to show actually, okay, this is just, we'll put just a square. Now, we will basically work with when our alpha 1 to alpha n are linearly independent. If they're linearly dependent, of course, this determinant square is going to be zero. So there is nothing to do that there. So we'll just pick up like alpha 1 to alpha n are linearly independent. This is one result that you can just see that discriminant, actually there is a good formula, discriminant and a trace. This is just right, like expand out and you will get the result. Okay.
Akash?
This is a good result. The discriminant.
Akash? Yeah. So the result which you just showed, the right hand side is the matrix ijth entry is going to be the trace of alpha I times alpha j.
Is the matrix. Trace of alpha I into alpha j. This is just if you expand it, you will get this. Like it is given there actually. So one main thing is like the discriminant is actually is in Z. That's something important. Oh, before that, I have to mention like actually why I am taking the square. That's a good thing. Okay, I'll do it later. I need something more. Yeah, but we can see this, that the discriminant of, if I pick a linearly independent interval, like if they're linearly dependent, we already have their zero, so they're in Z. There's no nothing to prove. But suppose we are taking, say, alpha is our algebraic integer, and they are also in say, some extension field of Q, say, of degree N, say, K, and they're linearly independent, will show that their discriminant is in Z. So basically, what are you doing? So basic trick is to show that whether for norm, trace, or discriminant, or more or less any kind of thing that we like will get in a number theory, is to actually, if you have a K over Q, some extension, we don't know whether it is Galois or not. Just do one thing, just take the Galois closure. Now, if you think about, after you have taken the Galois closure, what you do is like, what is your discriminant? It is actually some polynomial kind of expression in sigma I alpha j's and their product and some summation and then square. So now, if you actually take this, say the Galois closure of K is K bar, and now what is the automorphism group of out of say K bar as Q automorphism? It is just something you get when you extend this sigma I's. So everything, all the others, like say theta, it is an automorphism from the Galois group. If it is restricted to K, you will get that it is some embedding sigma I. So now when you have this determinant, the whole thing, the whole expression, now if you put any theta, you are applying any theta to the discriminant. So as like when you apply theta to the square, theta will go inside, and what will happen? You'll get some summation of theta sigma I alpha j. So what this theta does actually, this theta actually just permutes the alpha I's, and that's it. It just permutes the alpha I. And now that's why we are taking a square, because now even after permuting, it can be like differ up to plus minus one sign. Now if you just put a square outside, then you can show that, okay, if you apply any element from the Galois group, it doesn't change. If you take all the elements from the Galois group, and of course it fixes the discriminant, so it must be in the Q. So you can prove that, okay, it's now rational. Now what? Now is that if you have seen that, this discriminant is what? It is square of an expression, which is summation of sigma I alpha j kind of thing. Now the expression you get, it is actually what? Each sigma I alpha j, those are algebraic integer. You are multiplying some of them and then just taking summation. So the whole thing in the summation is going to be an algebraic integer, then you are taking its square, it's still going to be an algebraic integer. So it's an algebraic integer and it's a rational, hence it's going to be in Z. So the basic strategy is to prove that something is in Z, first prove that it is a rational, apply, just take the Galois closure, apply every sigma, show that sigma fixes it, so it is in Q, try to show that it's an algebraic integer, hence it will be in Z. Okay, yeah. This identity will need for a proof. So this is saying that discriminant of this thing is equal to this product. This the first identity is not that difficult. If you know there is like a matrix called van der Waals or whatever, that matrix, from there you will find it easily that this, the first two relations are same. For the second relation, what we do is, so if you just take F, say, have they done it? Okay. Anyway, I'll say that. if you take f now, if you just fx is what? Fx is now product of x minus alpha is, where alpha is at the root. So that's the thing, like let alpha 1 to alpha in the conjugate of alpha. So if you take the minimal polynomial of alpha, say it's f, so you take fx is equal to product of x minus alpha I. Now you just take f dash, so you will get some summation of x minus alpha I, and there will be some j omitted. Now just plug in the value alpha, like except one, everything will be cancelled out. Now you take the norm and you will get this result. Just expand f dash x, put alpha, you'll get the result. Okay. Oh, actually, yeah. Oh, sorry, they have done it. Yeah. So this is, yeah. So f dash alpha is alpha. R minus alpha is exactly that. You are just omitting one s or something. Then you are, when you are taking the norm, you are taking actually, you are then just permuting this alpha r. So you will see that it happens. Okay, so one thing we'll compute. It is very important. Just pay attention for this example. This is very important example. So far we don't know, if I take Q omega, what is going to be its ring of integer? We don't know. That actually we will see that it's going to be just Z omega. And to show that it is Z omega, we need this result, that it is discriminant is given by this P to the power P minus 2. So let us just start with this. So as we know that omega, say omega is a pth root of unity, so e to the power 2 pi I by p, then we know that it satisfies this equation 1 plus x square plus x to the power p minus 1, and we have seen that this is an irreducible polynomial over z. Now, what are you trying to do? So that as we have seen in the previous example, to compute the discriminant, what we have to do? We have to just get what is f dash x is, and just compute what is norm of f dash of omega is. So just differentiating just gets this p to the power x to the power p minus 1, blah, blah, blah. If you just put omega, this f term is vanishing. So you'll have f dash omega, and you're taking this omega to the power p minus 1 to the right hand side. So it is just 1 by omega. So the whole thing is here. So now if you calculate norm of f dash omega, and norm is multiplicative. So this thing, like, it distributes like denominator and this thing. So it is going to be norm of p by norm of omega into norm of omega minus 1. So as I said, that what is, so if you take for any integer, if you take any integer, say c from z, so what is going to be norm of c? So how are you getting norm? We are just multiplying, we're just taking product of sigma I of c. Now each sigma I is a q embedding, so it fixes c. So we'll have, like, if there are n embeddings, you will have c to the power n. So that's just it. It is the, there are p minus 1 embedding, and we will have p to the power p minus 1. So, and we need to show that y is norm of omega is 1, because we know that norm of the whole thing, like, in omega is a unit in here. So norm of omega will be 1. Because, like, I know that omega to the power p is equal to 1. So norm of omega to the power p is 1. So say norm of omega is alpha, so you have alpha to the power p is equal to 1. But here we know that norm of omega is in z, so we have something in z such that alpha to the power p is equal to 1, and we are taking p is, of course, greater than 2. Then we can, because for p is equal to 2, we have z I q I that we have already covered, that you can check that for p is equal to 2, q I string of integers is going to be z I. So we are taking p is greater than equal to 2. So norm of omega to the power this something is 1. That means that what? There is only one possibility. It is 1. So now we have norm of f dash alpha, which is a discriminant, is same thing as this norm of p by norm of omega minus 1. So now they're just claiming one thing, that norm of 1 minus omega is p. And this is very easy to see, actually. Like, just take the equation, that this equation, just take this equation, fx is equal to 1 plus x plus x square, x to the power p minus 1, right? So if you just factor it out, what are its factors? So x, it is just product of x minus omega I runs from 1 to p minus 1. Just now plug in the place of x, just plug in 1. So you get f of 1 is equal to product of 1 minus omega I's, omega to the power I's. And f of 1 is just p. So now you have product of 1 minus omega I is p. But what is this product of 1 minus omega to the power I? So if you think about the embeddings of Q omega, like where can omega go? Omega can go to another root of this fx. And what are the roots of fx? The roots of fx are just precisely omega to the power I. So we can see that f of 1 is equal to product of 1 minus omega I. Each omega I represents one of the embeddings. So we can say that this is going to be same thing as norm of 1 minus omega. So norm of 1 minus omega will be just p. So norm of omega is 1, norm of p is p to the power v minus 1, and norm of omega minus 1 is this p. So we'll have this norm of f dash of omega is going to be p to the power p minus 2. So just see this result. It is just follows the exact same thing. So in general, if you have why am I taking just p? I can take any m and consider the cyclotomic field of that, like omega m. So getting discriminant formula exactly for that is a bit complicated. The only thing we need is this formula, that m to the power phi m is equal to plus minus discriminant of omega into norm of omega z omega. Z is some polynomial in zx. So this formula. And they have asked that why norm of this thing is in z, because it is easy, because omega is in the ring of integers, and z omega, g omega is also going to be in the ring of integers. Its norm is in z. So hence you can show that actually that m to the power 5, we don't know what is the discriminant, but we at least know that it's going to be something which divides m to the power phi of m. Hence, you know that like if you take some power of a prime, not just p, say p to the power r, then you can say that you don't know what is going to be the discriminant, but you can say at least that okay, it's going to be some power of p. Okay, so before that, just let me say one thing. The most important setup, and just think in your head about a commutative diagram that you will see over and over and over again, which basically says that if you have, so what you will do, you will take a ring, an integral domain, which most of the time will be Noetherian, and we will impose some other conditions, like most of the time R will be a PID. So you are taking R, then you are taking its quotient field QR, so just name it K. So you have one extension R to K, and then you will take a finite extension which is separable over K. So you will have R to K and an extension L. Now you will take the integral closure of R in L. That means that I can think about R as a subring of L, and then I'm taking those elements in L which are integral over R. So of course they will make a ring, subring, which contains R. So just name it S. So we call that the integral closure of R. So you have a diagram, say R, K. Over K, you have a finite separable extension L, and you have S. So one thing, there is a theorem from a commutative algebra which states precisely that. So suppose your K to L extension, this extension's degree is N. And now you have taken R to be a PID, then you can actually say that the S you are going to get, the integral closure, it is going to be a free R module of rank N. So the algebraic closure, the integral closure, is going to be a free R module of rank N. So in our case, our R is going to be Z. So it is integral domain. It's a Noetherian ring, and it's a PID. And you have Q, and over Q, any extension is separable. And you are taking Q, K to be those number fields, which are finite extensions. So that property is also there. And now if you take our AC's integral closure is now just OK, the ring of integers in K. So from this theorem, from commutative algebra, you can actually say that OK is going to be a free Z module of rank N. This N is just same as the degree of the number field extension. That's the same. So here they are also saying the same thing with some additional conditions. So let alpha 1 to alpha n be a basis for K over Q, and each alpha 1 to alpha n is an algebraic integer. It is not a problem, because if you start with any, say over K, say any alpha 1 to alpha n, that as I have shown, you can always like multiply an integer with it, that like so that it becomes an algebraic integer. So we are in queue, so it doesn't really matter if we like we are taking a basis whether we just multiply with it some elements from Z or not. So if even if you start with any linearly independent say basis of K, then you can actually turn it into a collection of algebraic integers. Now these are the alpha 1 to alpha n. We have D. Now as D, this like alpha 1 to alpha n is linearly independent, D is never going to be zero. They're algebraic, they're linearly independent. So you have taken this D and we know that D is in Z. Now they're saying that not only that this whole thing, this whole OK is going to be just a free Z module of rank n, they're actually saying that if you start with any linearly independent basis, you can extend somehow this basis to a ring of basis for a ring of integers. So this is the expression, like summation mi alpha I by D, each of the mi's are in Z, and such that mi square is divisible or mj square is divisible by D. Okay. So this so you will get, as it is a free free Z module of rank n, you can always get some base like Z basis, some integral Z basis, which are and that basis we call it to be integral basis for OK. Now of course there will be lot of basis, but now if you have chosen say one basis, say alpha 1 to alpha n, so what you can do, you can compute its discriminant. What was the discriminant? That it is the matrix sigma I alpha j square, the determinant square. The matrix is aij, it is sigma I alpha j, you're taking the determinant and it's square. Now one might ask, like, why are they same? So you can take say two Z basis, say alpha 1 to alpha n and beta 1 to beta n. But if you take the Z basis, you will see that the base change matrix is actually a matrix from Z. So every entry is from Z. And if you just do this like obvious business of base change and everything, you will see that this matrix A, its determinant is either plus 1 or minus 1 as it is in Z. Now, if we didn't just take the square, we can say that, okay, if you take any two bases, say alpha 1 to alpha n and beta 1 to beta n, you can arrive to the conclusion, okay, their discriminant just differs by a plus minus sign. So if you just put a square, you can say, okay, it is like kind of like some number you, like it doesn't depend on the basis. So this is very example. That's, you are taking q root m, where m is, of course, you are taking m to be square free. So m can be, so if m is say congruent to 2 or 3, you can say that its ring of integer is going to be z root m. So everything, the basis is just going to be 1 and root m. But if you are taking say m is congruent to 1 mod 4, then its integral basis is going to be 1 plus root over m by 2. So this is like a very important thing to this, and it is easy to see that why it is. So before that, we can actually just use the discriminant of q root m. This is just going to be what you will have, like 1 root m and 1 root m, so it is going to be 4 m when m is 2 or 3, and if it is just 1 mod 4, you will see that okay, your discriminant is just going to be m. Yeah. Now comes this example. It is a kind of a big example. So before this, I should do something. Yeah, before this, I'll mention one result. Just let me just state some example. I'll do that in last. Before I'll try to show some examples, like some exercise, which actually works. Very useful. Yeah, just see this example, exercise 16, which says that if you take alpha to be fourth root of 2, so, and then take q alpha to be your ring of to the extension, then you can actually try to show that whether this root 3 is in q alpha or not. So how are you going to show that? Just write root 3 is like a plus b alpha plus c alpha, blah blah blah. Now if you think about it, this trace of alpha for alpha here, the trace of alpha is what? It is the x to the power 3 term, the coefficient of x to the power 3. And what is the minimal polynomial of fourth root of 2x to the power 4 minus 2? So you know that its trace is going to be 0. So if you just plug in now trace everything, and trace is as additive, so trace of root 3. So here when you're talking about trace, so I'm assuming root 3 is in q alpha. So I'm talking about basically t, k, q. So my k is fixed, it is q alpha. So trace of root 3, it's going to be a plus b alpha plus c alpha square plus d alpha q. So now you can show that trace is additive, and that b is a from rational, so it comes out. So other terms except this a just vanishes. It just vanishes. So we'll have t of a is equal to t of root 3, trace of root 3. But if you see, like as we have shown in the previous thing, remember there was one formula that takes like this capital T of alpha, and then it is n by d small t of alpha. So here, what is a small t of alpha? Here, first we are taking this big field, say q of alpha, q of fourth root of 2. Inside that, suppose there is root 3. So now my root 3 is just root 3 plus minus of root 3, because it is just the conjugation. Because the small t of alpha is just for when you are considering q of root over of 3, there is only two embeddings. One is just root 3 goes to root 3, the other is root 3 goes to minus root 3. So now if you see, your big T of root 3 is just n by d. Here n is 4, d is 2, so 4 by 2 small t of alpha, and for small t of alpha is 0, so you can say that big trace, the trace with respect to k, you can say that T of root 3 is 0. And we have already shown that this t alpha, t alpha square, and everything is already 0. So from there, you can see easily that this t of a is going to be 0. Now, if t of a is going to be 0, that means that a has to be 0 because a is in rational. So whenever you are just taking something from rational or from z, when you are taking t of that, it is just, if the degree of the extension is n, is just going to be n into a. So here it is 4, so 4 into a is 0, so you can say that a is 0. So now, again the same trick, you just take root 3. Now you know that root 3 is equal to b alpha plus c alpha square plus d alpha cube. You just take root 3 by alpha is equal to b plus c alpha square plus d alpha cube. Apply the same trick, you will get that b is 0. Then you will get c is 0. Then you will have that, okay, root 3 is equal to d alpha cube. But just take the square or something, like you from here you can prove that, because alpha cube is like 2 to the power 3 by 4. Just take this root 3 side, and you can show that d can't be rational. So from here you can actually see that, yeah, like this is not true. The root 3 can't be inside q alpha. So can everyone like follow me? I think I'm going a bit fast. Or does anyone have any problem? Okay, no. So fine. Okay. Yeah. Just look at this. The statement of like, I think Ash, just like look at this. Yeah.
Just reminding. Last 10 minutes. After that, for 5 minutes to 10 minutes, we will receive questions. So last 10 minutes. Can you finish? I mean, like you have 10 more minutes. That's all I want to say.
Okay. Then I'll just go back. I'll go back. Yeah. I don't think, I'll try. Maybe we might be able to solve this in 10 minutes. Yeah, so I don't like, this is a really a big example. I don't think I will be able to solve it, like say something about it in 10 minutes. So I'll just give you the statement that this is precisely the statement. Like, we want to first prove that if you have any omega, say it is in e to the power 2 pi I by m, where m is equal to p to the power r, any p prime, then you will have the ring of integers is just z. By a they mean that the big O, like we have said, the ring of all algebraic integers is just going to be z omega. And one thing is, the first line is trivial to show that z of 1 minus omega is z omega. and they will show that discriminant of 1 minus omega is just discriminant of omega, and they'll do it. For m is equal to p to the power, you are done. And now what will you do is that you will apply induction. Now say you have done for p to the power r. Now you take, say, so just think about what is going to happen with when you take m is equal to p into q. Now you will just take m is equal to p, like p into q, so you will take two extensions. Okay, one is k1, which is of q of omega p, and other one is q of omega of q. Now you will apply this like straightforward theorems from Galois theory and everything to actually show that it is the compositum makes the whole field, and they are just multiplies. Ring of integers just multiplies. So let me show one thing. Okay. Yeah. Just this is another very like this is something you will like you have to use at some point. Like there are a lot of algebraic number theory computation with this trick that actually says suppose okay now. Computing integral basis is very difficult thing. Like you see, for just cyclotomic q omega, there is this big theorem, like 3-4 pages to actually show, like okay, this is the integral basis. So computing integral basis in general is very hard. But one thing that first you might guess something and try to like prove something, okay, this is the integral basis or not. There is one lemma that is very helpful, which is like okay, so you take m to be a submodule of say in your ring of integers, okay, m is your z submodule, and it is also a free module of rank m. So when you take okay mod m, it is going to be some finite abelian group. Just from this classification of abelian groups, the theorem, you will get that okay mod m is some z mod nz. Now as you have okay, you can also like you can we have computed the discriminant of okay. For m also, you take some z basis of m, say beta 1 to beta n, you compute discriminant of m. Now there is a theorem that discriminant of m is equal to ok mod m, this order of ok mod m square, into discriminant of ok. So now if somehow you can say that, if it's okay, you have started with some number ring, now you have guessed for like, you have a guess for some ring of integers, like some integral basis. Somehow if you can compute that discriminant and show that okay it is square free, if you can show that okay this is square free, then you are done. Because otherwise okay will have some square factor, that square factor will actually come from okay mod n square. So if you can show that okay that thing is your square free, like you have started with m, and if you can show that your discriminant m is square free, then you are done. You know that that's exactly going to be okay, because okay mod m must be one. If it is something else, then you will have a square factor. So how can, like we can give like easily one example of that. So take, say, if you are in like, say, yeah, so when you are talking about z root m, so if you are talking about z root m, so m is 4k plus 1, right? Now what you do is we have calculated its discriminant, and we saw that its discriminant is just m. Now if you take m a square free number, then you can easily say that okay, my discriminant is this square free number, then this 1 plus root m by 2, if I take this z expansion of this, this is going to be my integral basis. So this is a like any useful tool to see this computation. So yeah, this is like the most of the part. So using to prove this, there is one statement to prove that ring of integers of q omega is just going to be z omega, which is actually a very useful thing that will come later. You'll need it later. Yeah. So So this is the statement. So suppose you have two number rings K and L over Q, and you take like the extension degree of K is M, and the degree of the extension of L is N. So and if you have this thing like K L, you take the compositum of the field. And you take its extension, the degree of the extension. If it is mn, if it is mn to n, similarly you take say r is okay and s is ol, the ring of integers in k and l respectively. You compute the discriminant. Say one is this car, one is this case. You compute the GCD. If that is d, then you take now t to be okl, means the ring of integers in the compositum, then you can show, say that T is going to be 1 by D RS. Now, suppose they are coprime. Like, if I take like two, as I've said, that if I take, say, P and Q for cyclotomic polynomial, cyclotomic field, if I'm taking two distinct prime, then I know that for P, my discriminant is P to the power V minus 2, some power of P. And for Q, my discriminant is some power of Q. So that GCD, the D will be 1. Then now you can show that the ring of integers of KL or T is inside RS. So if you can somehow prove that, we already know from this theorem that T is inside RS. If you can prove that RS contains T, then you can show that T is just R into S. And from this, actually, you can prove that for any M, the cyclotomic extension, omega M, its ring of integer is just going to be Z omega. So this is the thing that you'll be need in the proving the following. And that's it. This is the first chapter. This is the first chapter of Marcus. That's it. You can do like lots of problems there from Marcus. So yeah, that's it.
Akash, are you done?
Yeah, I'm done. I just said that. Like, this is the whole chapter. Chapter 2 is essentially the whole thing. This thing. There is nothing more.
Yeah. So, okay. Let's all unmute the speaker and like thank Akash once. Yeah. Like, give. Virtual clapping. Yeah.
Virtual clapping.
If anyone has doubts,
feel interested, try to do.
If anyone has doubts, they can ask. I mean, like, you can take questions now.
Yeah, like, could you follow? Like, I tried to give like as much argument as I could, but I don't know. I mean, I feel kind of it was like not very connected well or going fast or something like that because I'm not writing anything.
Yeah, people who have attended have to say feedback. Yeah.
It felt rushed through.
Yeah, you can.
So. Like next day, I think Srijan might talk about the next chapter, which is basically says like how prime splits in bigger extension. Like if you are in Z, if you are thinking about Zi, so how a prime in P actually splits in Zi. So you know from Gauss's theorem that if it is a 4k plus 1 forms prime, it will split in 2 primes, and it is a 4k plus 3 prime, prime of form 4k plus 3, it is going to remain a prime. So that kind of thing, like if you take any extension, how actually primes in P in Z actually splits into this bigger extension field. So that's the next chapter, I think, and it actually tells you that if you there is something called a Dedekind domain that like in PID, what we have, if I take any ideal, I know that for UFD, if I take any X, if it is a UFD, we know that it has a factorization into elements, but that might not be true for number rings, that all number rings are not UFD, but you have something general that you don't have factorization in terms of elements, but now if you can take any ideal I, then you can say it has a factorization into prime ideals, like some product of PI and I. That is a like called the Dedekind factorization theorem. That is the main theorem from the next part, next chapter.
Thank you. If no one has any questions, I think we can again thank Akash and finish this off.
Yeah. Okay. Chalo.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, I will let you know, guys, when is the next talk. I'll keep posting in the group and follow the group for updates. Yeah. I'll end the meeting now. Thank you.